Hello all, welcome to the channel. Today I'll break down the hottest topic since a few months now of ChatGPT. It's the fastest growing app in the history, reaching around 100 million active users in just 2 months. In this video, I'll help you develop from scratch an intuitive technical understanding of how ChatGPT works. Let's jump right into it. To understand ChatGPT, we need to understand LLMs and RLHF. LLMs stands for large language models. RL in RLHF stands for reinforcement learning, and HF stands for human feedback. Now, models here refer to machine learning models, and large refers to a lot of parameters. And these days, when we talk about machine learning models with a lot of parameters, we usually are talking about deep neural networks. And one specific architecture of deep neural networks is called GPT, which stands for Generative Pre-trained transformer. So that's the GPT in ChatGPT. That will be the first thing that we'll talk about in this video. The second part of the video, we'll talk about reinforcement learning using human feedback. That's the magic that makes this go from GPT to ChatGPT. And we'll talk about things like instructor tuning and chain of thought reasoning. So let's get started. This fun cartoon from New Yorker is a good reflection of what large language models do at a high level, in that they are just next word predictors on steroids. But in order to predict the next word, you need to understand language. Here's why. In the 80s, there were attempts to hard code grammatical rules into the computers, such as what are nouns and verbs and what follows what, so that the computer can predict the next word of a sequence. The approach wasn't very successful, because what we quickly learned was that it wasn't just the grammatical rules, but also our prior context that helped us determine the meaning of a given sentence. For example, in this case, we need to know that truck has drivers, people obey police officers, trucks have brakes that will cause them to stop, drivers can step on the brake to stop the truck. For the exact same sentence structure, if we change the noun to Wonder Woman, it will have a completely different interpretation. Here, we will draw upon our knowledge of a fictional character, and we understand that Wonder Woman applies physical force to stop the truck. Our understanding of these two sentences goes far beyond the meanings of the individual words, plus the grammatical rules, which are basically the same in both sentences. So we humans understand language in a way that is grounded in sensation and action. And this is how computers need to understand language. Another approach for language modeling that was popular in the late 90s and early 2000s was statistical NLP, which follows a well-known linguistic theory which was put forth in 1957 by J.R. Firth. Let's take an example to understand this. Let's say you want to predict the next word after first CEO of Amazon is. Now, one way to do this is you create a large matrix of V rows, where V is the size of the vocabulary, which is basically all the words that occur in English language. And then you also have V columns, such that now for each word in the English vocabulary, you have the probability of the word that could occur next. So in this example, to predict the next word after is, you go into the row corresponding to is, and then you choose the word that corresponds to the maximum value in that row. So in this case, it looks like Andy might have the largest probability to come next. Now, this table on the left looks at just one word before. What if we look at two words before? Now, that's called a bigram. Now, the number of the rows increases to V squared, all possible combination of two words, and you're still predicting what's the next word after a bigram. So in this case, the next word after Amazon is, so you look at the probability of each word that can come next, and you pick the word that has the largest probability. Now, you and I can easily see why both unigram or bigram approach will fail in this case, because you have to see at least five words before to know what could be the next word. So in this case, since it's asking for the first CEO of Amazon, it's gonna be Jeff Bezos. Now, you can argue that we can perhaps do pentagrams. So now you need to have higher n-grams to capture the long-term dependency. But higher the n-grams, more the rows in this matrix, leading to higher computational complexity. Instead, we can do something sly. While still making a second order model, we can consider the combinations of the most recent word with each of the words that came before. So for example, if this is a vocabulary and we want the computer to predict the next word after is, like the following, where the columns is still the size of the vocabulary, but rows are the combination of the most recent word with each of the word that came before. So it is still second order because we are only considering two words at a time, but it allows us to reach back further and capture long range dependencies. tendencies. The difference between this and what we did before with bigrams is that we discard most of the word order information and combinations of preceding words. What remains is still pretty powerful. The first thing that becomes apparent is that when trying to predict the next word after is, we no longer look at just one line, but we look at the whole set of them. As each row no longer represents the state of the sequence at a particular point, instead each row represents one of the many features that may describe the sequence at a particular point. The combination of the most recent word with each of the words that came before makes for a collection of applicable rows, maybe a large collection. And because of this change in meaning, each value in the matrix no longer represents a probability, but rather a vote. Votes will be summed and compared to determine the next word prediction. So in this case, we see the feature first is getting zero weight for word Andy, but getting a very high weight for the word Jeff, thereby indicating that it holds a bigger importance in predicting the next word after is. Now that matrix can also be represented in the following form, where each of these nodes are the features, these were the rows in the matrix, and the intensity of the arrows here represent the value in the matrix, that is the weight. Now this is more commonly known as neural network. For a moment, if we ignore our current example and think about a scenario where we want to predict the price of a house based on the features like area of the house, number of rooms, number of bathrooms, whether it has a terrace or not, and so on. And let's say this is location and rooms, and then the final thing that we're predicting is price. So in this scenario, we'll have all of these features and we'll have the final price, and then we will try to learn the weights on these arrows in the model. And in this scenario, it looks like the model learned that location and room are the two important features that determine the final price of the house. In fact, the beauty of neural net and its strongest attribute is that it's able to extract important features that are indicative of the final prediction we want to make. So in this example, we don't even need to start with specifying the features. What we can even do is move one step back and just provide image pixels of the house, the rooms, and so on, and let the model learn what are the important features from that image. Coming back to our original example, what this means is that we can just provide the model all the words in the vocabulary and let its internal layers, these are called hidden layers, learn what are the important features, i.e. combinations of words that would be indicative of the next word we are trying to predict. We still need to pass a representation of each word, and computers understand numbers. So one way we could do this is use one-hot encoding, where again, this is the size of the vocabulary, and we put a one next to the position of the word we want to represent and zeros elsewhere. As you would imagine, this is very compute intensive. Instead, what we actually use to represent words is word2vec embeddings. These are of much less dimensions, around 300. The word2vec paper came around 2013, and I have a detailed video on my channel explaining how we build these. For now, assume you have a much lower dimensional representation of each word, which we pass through and try to predict the next word. Although one shortcoming of using word2vec representations is that certain words that have multiple meanings, like apple, which could be a company, or the fruit, will have just one single representation. So let's see next how we get around that in ChatGPT. In 2017 came the Transformer paper from Google, titled Attention is All You Need, which may be the innovation of the decade. But before understanding Transformer, let's understand attention. Let's say you want to predict the next word after my Apple iPhone is. As we discussed, we can take word2vec representations of each of these words, but we have the limitation with word2vec that these representations for words that could be used in different contexts are the same. So what we intuitively want to have is an updated representations of these words that are in the context of the paragraph or the sentence that they are being used in. So the representation of apple gets updated such that the new representation is closer to the meaning of the company and not to the fruit. So the way we do this is we take the representation of apple and do a dot product with the representations of words around it. The dot product of these gives us new weights, and then we weight these matrices by the weight that we got and sum them all together, come up with the updated representation of app. So in summary, in order to update the word2vec representation of a word to be more contextualized, we take the representation of the words, we do a dot product of that with the neighboring words to come up with weights. Once we have the weights, we take a weighted sum to come up with the new updated contextualized word representation. Now here I show the update for the word apple, but you can imagine the representations for each of these words getting updated in parallel using the same method. One last consideration is that these embeddings right now do not have any position knowledge. That is to say that if these four words were in any other order, it would still have learned the same embeddings. Clearly, we want our state-of-the-art language model to have at least some sensitivity to word order, so this needs to be fixed. The solution is simple. We create a second vector of equal length that represents the position of the word in the current sentence, and we add this to the embedding. Hopefully this helps you get an intuitive understanding of the main benefit behind this architecture, which is to make it efficient so that there is no need to read data in sequence. There are no recurrent connections. There's just attention. This means that all of these matrix operations inside the model can be parallelized, leading to a much faster training and enabling the training of the model on huge amounts of data. Finally, for completeness, do notice that each initial word representation plays three roles in this computation. One, it is compared with every other vector to establish the weights for its own output. Similarly, it's also compared to every other vector to establish the weights for their outputs. And finally, it is used as the weighted sum to compute each output vector once the weights have been established. These three roles are often referred to as key, query, and values. Now, with the understanding of attention, we have all of the components to introduce the transformer block. So the transformer block is made up of the self-attention block that we just discussed, layer normalization blocks, which are essentially to ensure that the weights do not explode or vanish, and the feed-forward neural networks. Also recall that the inputs are represented using their word-to-vec representation and the positional encoding, and the task is to predict the next word after the sequence. Note that this is an auto-regressive model, which simply means that at each time step, you can take the output here as input and predict the next word. Now to recall, the attention layer essentially takes the word-to-vec and positional embeddings and comes up with a more contextualized representation of each word, and the individual feed-forward neural networks, they try to predict the next words in the sequence. Now, this is just one transformer block. In reality, generated pre-trained transformer consists of multiple transformer blocks. In fact, GPT-3 is 96 layers of transformer blocks with a total of 175 billion parameters. And while I show four words being taken as input to predict the next word, GPT-3 can read and generate up to 2048 tokens at a time. So this was the first section of the discussion today, where we developed an understanding of GPT. Now the next part is going from GPT to ChatGPT. Now the model has the knowledge of the language, but we need three more steps to get it to a stage where we can interact with it. First is fine tuning. Second is human feedback. And third is reinforcement learning. Let's get started. Now we have GPT, which is trained on vast amount of internet data with an objective to predict the next word. So out of the box, it has this tendency to do pattern completion. So for example, we might say Amazon's first CEO is, and it might give the next word output as Jeff Bezos. But what if the input is a question, who is Amazon's first CEO? GPT might just complete the sentence and output, and when did he found Amazon? So we need to do some kind of supervised fine tuning that demonstrates GPT the kind of outputs we expect from it. The way we typically do this is by fine tuning it on a human created ground truth dataset of prompts and their response. GPT looks at a sufficiently large enough dataset of prompts and the response it's supposed to generate for those prompts that the model uses to adapt to generate outputs that are more in line with our expectations. Another thing that is unique about the data that is used to fine-tune GPT is encouraging a chain of thought reasoning while generating the response. This allows GPT to generate more tokens in the output and use those tokens to generate better predictions. After fine-tuning GPT, we then use the fine-tuned model's responses and feed them to a human's annotators to rate them in step two. So let's say we give this prompt to our fine-tuned supervised GPT from step one. The prompt is, today we will have French, and we ask the model to complete it. And let's say we give this prompt to the model four different times and generate four different outputs. We then ask human annotators to rate these outputs in the order of best to worst. And then we train a separate neural net model. We call this a rewards model that takes the prompt and the model's output together, and it tries to predict what would have been the reward provided by the human. The idea is to train the separate reward model to evaluate the output of our supervised fine-tuned GPT so that in step three, we won't need humans, but directly use the reward model's output to evaluate our fine-tuned GPT. So finally, tying it all together in step three, we use the fine-tuned GPT from step one and the reward model from step two to continuously update the parameters of that GPT model using reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning simply is an agent, which is our GPT model here, doing an action, and then an environment, in this case, our reward model, providing a reward on that action. So that agent is incentivized to generate responses that provide higher rewards from the rewards model. And this is how we get to ChatGPT. So we covered a lot in 15 minutes today. With the pace of advancement in this field recently, a lot of the things that we discussed today might be outdated next week. But hopefully you leave with an intuitive understanding of the technology behind ChatGPT. Thanks for your time.